Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, wherever you are, whatever you're doing. Welcome to Walking Through the Book of Genesis. I'm your host, Ruel Barksdale, and we will be walking through this 49th chapter of the book of Genesis today. Only two more chapters to go before we move into the book of Exodus. So grab a pencil, grab some paper, get your Bible, get your iPad, wherever you keep the Word of God. Call a friend, call an enemy, and let them walk through this chapter with you. The book of Genesis, the 49th chapter. Now, there are many times it seems like in our current political stage that we're arguing over history. What should be taught? What should we learn? What should we not learn? But as I've told you often as we've been walking through Genesis, Genesis is the book of first. And so in this chapter, not only is history important, but the foretelling of history, what history will be, what the future will be, is important. And so in this chapter, for the first time, we're going to see a conscious man provide what, not history, but what the future will be. And you'll see throughout the rest of the Bible, this prophecy becomes true. Each of the 12 tribes of Israel is prophesied over in this 49th chapter. And so as Jacob prepares to leave the scene, as Jacob prepares to move on and blesses and or foretells what would happen to each of his sons, we see a very special chapter. And we see right here also what's a beautiful thing. We see the prophecy of Christ. So settle in as we walk through the 49th chapter of the book of Genesis. Now, I don't know about you, but I have thoroughly enjoyed our walk thus far, the things that God has showed us, the things that God has revealed, the beautiful things that we have been able to see as we walk through this book. Today, I'm going to look at a commentary by David Guzik, who does some very special things for us. So I'm going to actually, I have not done this throughout the whole chapter of Genesis, throughout the whole book of Genesis, but today I'm going to read a little bit of his work because it is so illuminating and I believe it will be a blessing to us. Is that all right? Okay. Genesis 49. Now, we have seen so far that Jacob has been reunited with his favorite son, Joseph, and has already blessed Joseph's sons, and now, because he realizes that he's about to die, he wants to bring in all of his sons and talk to them for a little bit. I thought about that, and I thought about some of the people in my life that even not too long ago, an elderly man in my life called me and encouraged me and inspired me to keep on doing a few things. And little did I know that he was about to die. But there's something about when you know that it's your time, you not just want to leave a legacy, you want to leave some wisdom. You want to leave some understanding. You want to leave some instruction. And I have had several moments in my life where people have done that, even though I did not know necessarily that they were about to move from time to eternity. And so in this 49th chapter, Jacob is compelled, he's persuaded, he's moved to bring in each of his sons. I'm going to talk to you. I'm going to tell you some things that are going to happen. I'm not going to talk to you about history. I'm going to talk to you about the future. And praise God, how do you know a prophecy is true? If what was said happens, then we know that that must have been a God thing. All right, are you ready? All right, so let's go to the 49th chapter, and it reads like this. Then Jacob called for his sons and said, gather around so I can tell you what will happen to you in the days to come. He's telling them, I don't know if you can feel the significance of this, but in the Bible so far, this type of prophecy has never happened. Oh, yeah, we have Genesis 3:15 where the Spirit of God said, but we've never had a man We've never had prophecy come through a man before. And so he said, gather around that I might tell you what shall befall you in the last days. Gather together and hear, you sons of Jacob, and listen to Israel, your father. Now, it's also interesting to me that he understands at this most critical moment in his life that he is still Jacob and still Israel. He doesn't forget where he came from. He doesn't forget God's blessings on him. He doesn't forget how his growth. You see, sometimes we judge people for where they are, not understanding that God is taking them someplace. Sanctification is a process. Don't judge me while I'm in process. Matter of fact, don't judge me at all. But if you have to judge me, don't judge me while I'm in process. Sanctification is a process. And where I was yesterday doesn't necessarily have to determine where I am tomorrow. Where I am today does not necessarily have to determine where I'm going. And so he says, gather around, assemble and listen, sons of Jacob. Listen to your father, Israel. You're the sons of Jacob, but I'm going to speak to you as Israel. When I had you, I was Jacob, but I've grown into to Israel. And your seed will be called by my latter name, Israel. Reuben. Now, understand that the oldest child usually gets a double portion of the inheritance. But Reuben has some issues, y'all. Reuben was he had some immorality issues because he slept with his father's concubine, Bilhah. You remember that. He was unstable. And so what we get from this is that sometimes, even though God has put us in a place of blessing, our own choices can forestall what God has planned for us. Reuben was the firstborn. Reuben should have had a double portion. Reuben should have laid claim to the major inheritance, but he couldn't because he wouldn't. He wouldn't be what God had called him to be, the firstborn, the leader. Reuben, you are my firstborn, my might, the first sign of my strength. Reuben, you're the first child I ever had. You were an indication that God was indeed going to bless me, that with to be the father of many nations. Reuben, you were it. You were the one. Excelling in honor, excelling in power, turbulent as the waters, you will no longer excel. For you went up into your father's bed, unto my couch, and you defiled it. Reuben, you had it, but now you've lost it. As the firstborn of the family, Reuben had claim to the inheritance rights of the firstborn, but he forfeited it through pride and through immorality. Reuben's immorality, again, with his father's concubine, Bilhah, is recorded in Genesis 35:22. Reuben, you're unstable. You're unstable as water. You will not excel. Why? Because of Reuben's instability, the birthright was divided. In other words, I'm going to give what should have been you to some of your brothers. I'm going to have to split it up because you can't inhabit it. You can't inherit it. You can't experience what could have been yours. My brother, my sister, it's a horrible thing to be gifted, to be talented, to be called, and yet be unstable. To not be able to inhabit, to inherit what God has called you to be. Don't let that be the story of your life. And we'll see that when he's speaking to his children, some of his children don't get what they could have had because of their will. Not because of God's way, not because of God's will, not because of God's word, but because of their will, because of their way, and even because of their word. Simeon and Levi. You remember Simeon and Levi when their sister was defiled and they went and killed all the men of the city? You remember Simeon and Levi. Simeon and Levi are brothers, their swords are weapons of violence. Let me not enter their council, Let me not join their assembly, for they have killed men in their anger and hamstrung oxen as they pleased. Cursed be their anger, so fierce, and their fury so cruel. I will scatter them in Jacob. As a father, as the man, I will scatter their inheritance. I will divide it up. I will scatter them in Jacob. Oh, God, I will and disperse them in Israel. Two different sides here. We're going to see what happens that with. There's a difference between Simeon and Levi. And Kuzik says, the second-born son Simeon and the third-born son Levi received the same words for the same evil deed. They were instruments of cruelty when they wiped out all the men of Shechem in retaliation for the rape of their sister Dinah. Jacob, perhaps in weakness, did nothing at the time except register a small self-centered complaint. Remember, he said, look what you've done to me. Yet he remembered this event. This illustrates the principle that the sins of our past can come back to haunt us. Even when forgiven, they may carry consequences we must face for a lifetime. And so he says, I will divide them in Jacob and scatter them in Israel. The prophecy of dividing and scattering turned out to be a curse for Simeon. The tribe of Simeon was the weakest numerically of the 12 tribes. When you go to Numbers 26:14, and when you go to looking at the land of Judah, Joshua 19:1, the tribe of Simeon became small during the wilderness wanderings. They started out from Egypt and being the third largest tribe. But some 35 years later, at the second wilderness census of Israel, 63% of the tribe perished, and they became the smallest tribe. You've lost your place. I will divide them in Jacob and scatter them in Israel. The prophecy of dividing and scattering became a blessing for Levi. Why? Why was he different from Simeon when they both occupied the same space of cruelty? Why was Levi different? And we, right here, we see God's grace, we see God's mercy, we see the ability for us to turn. And even though we've been walking down the wrong road, if we turn, if we repent from our sins, repent means to turn around and go in a different direction. This is what happens to Levi. The prophecy dividing and scattering became a blessing for Levi because of the faithfulness of this tribe during the rebellion of the golden calf, which we'll look at when we get to Exodus. It was scattered as a blessing, not a curse, throughout the whole nation of Israel. They received no large tract of land, for the Lord was their inheritance, not the land. So remember, Simeon and Levi were scattered, but one as a blessing and the other as a curse. Remember, Levi becomes the tribe of the Levitical priest. Why? Because when the golden calf was being worshipped, it was the Levitical people that said, no, not so. Not so. Levi gained a blessing at the hands of Moses, one of the richest blessings of any of the other tribes, because of his stance when the whole nation wanted to go the wrong way. So the beautiful thing about this, my brother, my sister, is we all have a past. We have things that if we had it to do over again, hopefully we would do it differently. But when we begin to see the blessings of God and the call of God on our lives, and we move in the direction that he would have us to move, it's not too late to receive a blessing. Simeon and Levi both involved in the same foolishness and the same cruelty. Simeon never turned. Levi did. And now we come to the fourth son, Judah. Oh, Judah. The scepter shall not depart from Judah. What does that mean? What does that mean? You don't see any kings, any judges, any priests coming from Reuben or Simeon. Look at your history. You'll see that the kings, the priests, the leaders of the nation, in large part, come from Judah. Judah, you, and remember, Judah was the one that said, well, let's not throw Joseph into the pit and let him die. Let's sell him. So his hands weren't clean. But again, when you turn from your wicked ways, God has an ability and an opportunity and a desire to use you. Judah, you are he whom your brother shall praise. Your hand shall be on the neck of your enemies. Your father's children shall bow down before you. Judah is a lion's whelp. From the prey, my son, you have gone up. He bows down. He lies down as a lion. And as a lion, who shall arouse him? The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet until Shiloh comes. Now, Shiloh? Who's Shiloh? Shiloh is determined interpreted as the Messiah. Judah, you will rule the nation. Judah, you will out of your belly shall come kings and leaders of the nation. And the rule of God shall not depart from your hand until Shiloh comes, until the Messiah comes. Nor a lawgiver from between his feet until Shiloh comes. And to him shall be the obedience of the people, binding his donkey to the vine, the choicest of land, and his donkey's colt to the choice vine. He washed his garments in wine, and his blood in the blood of grapes, and his clothes rather in the blood of grapes. His eyes are darker than wine, and his teeth whiter than milk. Let's go back and unpack that. Judah, you are whom your brother shall praise. Judah wasn't a completely exemplary character. Remember, he suggested a prophet to get rid of Joseph in Genesis 37:26. He did not deal faithfully with his daughter-in-law Tamar in Genesis 38:26. And he had sex with her as a prostitute, Genesis 38:18. But he showed good character when he interceded and offered himself as a substitute for Joseph. Overall, this blessing is an example of the richness of God's grace to the undeserving. My brother, my sister, God doesn't bless you because you deserve it. But where's your heart? In the process of being sanctified, are you moving forward or are you moving backward? Are you moving toward God or are you moving away from him? And Judah, and I believe there's a point in everyone's life, there is a critical point where you have to make a decision. Where you're mature enough, where you've grown enough, where you're experienced enough to make a conscious decision, which way am I going to go? And at some point in his life, Judah said, I'm going to go towards God. Reuben didn't make that choice. Simeon didn't make that choice. Levi started to make that choice, and so did Judah. And so because Judah, even though Judah is the fourth in line, not the first, not the second, not the third, the scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver between his feet until the Messiah comes. Blessed is Judah among all of his brothers. Oh my God, thank God for grace. Thank God for mercy. And then he goes on to talk about some of the brothers that we haven't heard a lot about. And this is a blessing to me also, because this says your name might not be on the marquee. Your name might not be yelled across the podium, across the pulpit, across the platform. Your name might not be heralded amongst the crowds. But that doesn't mean there's not a blessing for you. And so keep doing good when nobody's calling your name. Keep doing good when everybody seems to be ignoring you. Keep doing good when others are getting the praise and the glory. Keep doing good. Why? Because we see Zebulun. We haven't heard about Zebulun. We haven't heard about Issachar. We haven't heard about Dan. And we skip some and go all the way down to the end of the line. But Zebulun will live by the seashore and become a haven for ships. His border will extend towards Sidon. Issachar is a raw-boned donkey lying down between two saddlebags. When he sees how good is his resting place and how pleasant is his land, he will bend his shoulder to the burden and submit to forced labor. So Issachar, you're strong, you're mighty, you're talented, but you might be a little bit lazy. And so because of that, you're going to submit to forced labor. Dan will provide justice for his people. As one of the tribes of Israel, Dan will be a serpent by the roadside, a viper along the path that bites the horse. Now, see, this is a beautiful thing, and I hope you're getting how important this chapter is, because we're not talking about history in the past. We're foretelling what's going to happen in the future. And Dan is Dan shall judge his people. The tribe of Dan did judge his people. They supplied one of the most prominent of judges, Samson. Remember that? Dan shall be a serpent by the way. What does that mean? Well, Guzik says Dan was a troublesome tribe. They introduced idolatry into Israel. Jeroboam set up one of his idolatrous golden calves in Dan. And later, Dan became a center of idol worship in Israel. Some think the serpent, by the way, refers to the idea that the Antichrist would come from the tribe of Dan based on Daniel 11:37. Dan is left out of the listing of tribes regarding the 144,000 in the book of Revelations, but Dan is the first tribe listed in Ezekiel's millennial roll call of the tribes. This is a remarkable sign of God's redemption. Dan. And then after Dan, we go to Gad. Gad will be attacked by a band of raiders, but he will attack them at their heels. Asher's food will be rich. He will provide delicacies fit for a king. Naphtali is a doe set free that bears beautiful fawns. Joseph, my favorite Joseph, the one who I thought was dead, the one who told me as when he was a child that his mother and me would bow down from Joseph, the one that I gave a coat of many colors. Joseph, the firstborn of my beloved Joseph, who is now a ruler. Joseph, come closer. Let me talk to you. Joseph is a fruitful vine near a spring whose branches climb over a wall. With bitterness, archers attacked him. They shot at him with hostility, but his bow remained steady. He didn't bow in the face of adversity. He didn't backslide in the face of trials and tribulations. His strong arm stayed limber because of the hand of the mighty one of Jacob, because of the shepherd, the rock of Israel, because of your father's God who helps you, because of the Almighty who blesses you with blessings of the heavens above, blessings of the deep that lies below, blessings of the breast and womb. Your father's blessings are greater than the blessings of the ancient mountains, than the bounty of the age-old hills. Let all these rest on the hand of not Reuben, not Simeon, not Levi, not Joseph, on the brow of the prince among his brothers. Joseph. My brother, my sister, I don't care what title somebody has, what position they think they have. When God's hand is on your life, when God's anointing is on your life, when God has chosen to bless you, the room will always shift to you. Jacob could say the blessings were on Joseph because he was, for much of his life, a scoundrel himself. Now, at the end of his days, he saw just how good God was to him. He was forgiven much, and he loved likewise. The mighty God of Jacob, in his words about Joseph, Jacob listed five great titles for God. These titles show that Jacob did come to an understanding of who God is. He refers to God as the mighty God of Jacob, the shepherd, the stone of Israel, the God of your father, and the Almighty. Joseph, every dream that you had came true. Joseph, the hand of God was with you in the pit. It was with you in the prison. It was with you in the palace, and it will be with you into the future, Joseph. And finally, we move to Benjamin, the youngest of Jacob's tribe. Benjamin is a ravenous wolf. In the morning he devours the prey. In the evening he divides the plunder. All these are the... Okay, so what is he saying to Benjamin? Benjamin is a ravenous wolf. This was the tribe with a reputation of fierceness. He shall devour his prey. To see the great extent of this, look at Ehud, or Judges 3, 15 through 23, Saul, Samuel 1, 9, 1, 14 through 47 and 52, and Paul, Acts 8, 1 through 3. The cruelty of the tribe in general is seen in Judges 19 and 20. And so now Jacob concludes the blessings on his son. He hasn't talked about history so much as he's talked about what history will be, what will happen when he's gone. I'm about to close my eyes. I'm about to go to my ancestors. But I needed to sit down and talk with each of my sons to give them some wisdom, to give them some understanding. Then he gave them these instructions. I'm about to be gathered to my people. Bury me with my fathers in the cave in the field of Ephraim and the Hittite, the cave in the field of Machpelah near Mamre, in Canaan, which Abraham brought as a burial place from the Ephraim, the Hittite, along with the field where Abraham and his wife Sarah were buried. I'm about to leave now. When Jacob had finished giving instructions to his sons, he drew his feet up into the bed. He breathed his last and was gathered to his people. My God, my God. My brothers, my sisters, oftentimes we wonder, what will I leave to my children? And usually when somebody says that, they're thinking about land, they're thinking about houses, they're thinking about riches. But can you leave them some wisdom? Can you leave them some understanding? Can you bless them with the knowledge of God? As we get into Exodus, and as you study the rest of the Bible, you'll see that everything that Jacob said in the 49th chapter comes to pass. What a God. Ooh, listen, next week we'll do our last chapter in the book of Genesis. So tell a friend, tell an enemy about our walk through the book of Genesis, and perhaps by the time our walk is over, you and your enemy will be friends. I love you. God loves you more. See you next week. Bye-bye.